Webinar is planned for about 30-35 minutes, so I'll spend about 25-30 minutes to talk about the topic. And if you have any questions, you can post this question on hashtag Ask Nullcon, or you can drop me an email at the specified email ID. So we are coming out with our 2019 DDoS threat report, and a quick preview on that, on the threats, as we have seen last year, is that we've seen the largest DDoS attack of 1.35 terabit per second, which happened last year in February against GitHub. This attack is also the largest known attack in the history of DDoS. There was also another claim of an attack of 1.7 terabit per second, but that remains unsubstantiated. So the large attack still remains officially as this figure. So what we've seen is that the attacks have been increasing at a rate of 150% year over year, with over 2,000 attacks that we are seeing on a daily basis. Mind you, these are the attacks that actually get reported. There are many attacks that either are not disclosed or go under the radar and don't even get detected. Also, about 1/3 of all downtime events on websites can be attributed to DDoS attack. Not just this, the duration of a DDoS attack is also increasing, as we have seen in 2018. The largest duration of a DDoS attack was at 14 days nonstop. And on an average, we see a DDoS attack that ranged from anywhere between 6 hours to 8 hours. As you all know, DDoS attack is fairly simple to launch. It's basically, you can go you buy a service like a DDoS attack as a service from online, or you can run your own tool. Many of them are actually open source tools. And it also costs really cheap. It costs about $150 per week. But the other side is very different. Mitigating a DDoS attack can be very, very challenging. And not just that, the target of the attack can have to bear more than $40,000 for every hour of downtime because of a DDoS attack. Last year, throughout the year, FBI actually put about 15 DDoS attack services behind bars. They shut down those websites. So while the buying such attack services is still challenging, but anybody who has access to the underground market can still buy these services at a fairly cheap rate. So if I talk about the evolution of the attack per se, the biggest is the capability in terms of size. In 2008, the largest attack that we saw was 8 Gbps. Today, it's 1.5 terabit per second. That's a huge difference. And it's not just the size. If you look at the resourcefulness of the attackers, they've started using other vectors of attack, such as IoT devices and mobile phones. An example of IoT device was in 2016, we saw Mirai botnet, which leveraged security cameras and DVR solutions to perpetrate a very large attack of over 1 terabit per second. This is a looping threat using a LOPI toolkit. This is basically a toolkit which is trying to infect Android phones. And very soon we'll start seeing large volume attack using mobile phones as well. If I talk about the innovation in terms of DDoS attacks, what we are seeing is that the attackers are using new threats vectors such as amplification attack. In this attack, we are seeing various protocols being misused to launch a reflection and amplification attack, like DNS amplification, NTP amplification, SSDP, and many other services. Now, the aim of the attacker in this case is to launch a very small volume attack and send to these services, which in turn generate a huge volume of traffic, which is then forwarded onto the actual target. So it's not a direct attack, but an indirect attack mechanism of perpetrating a large volume DDoS attack. The other innovation that the attackers are using is in terms of various applications that they're trying to misuse to launch the attack. We've seen attack using memcached, which is used for caching, in-memory caching. We've seen attack using Hadoop, which is used for big data analysis. We have universal plug-and-play devices, which are also being used, misused to launch an attack. And CoOP and MQTT are protocols for IoT devices, which are basically used for perpetrating new vectors of attacks. When we talk about the intent, so previously attackers used the DDoS, successful DDoS mitigation used to be categorized as an attack, which was able to successfully bring down a website. But if you look at the evolution of the internet and how user perceive a website to be usable, the attack, successful attack may not necessarily mean that the website is completely down or offline. If you slow down the website so much so that it takes more than 2 seconds, which is an average load time for a website, or you the website starts loading with incomplete pages like missing JavaScript or missing CSS files, it almost becomes almost unusable. And users start flocking to other competitive websites. So just spoiling a user experience is also a successful DDoS attack. And DDoS attacks were primarily used to bring down the services and target the availability of a service. But awfully, these attacks are also used for other purposes. See, a lot of organizations put firewalls, IPS, IDS, and other security controls in place to protect their entire network. But these devices operate in the form of fail open safe, which means that if these devices cannot handle the traffic or they themselves go down, they will allow the traffic to pass through unmitigated. So DDoS attacks are basically launched initially to bring these security controls down so that they go into fail open safe mode. And at that point of time, the small window that the attackers have, they will actually launch an attack to infect the network or the website which is being targeted. So this way, the DDoS attack is only acting as a distraction. So security team starts focusing on something else while the attacker has an intent to actually compromise the network. And lastly, the sophistication of the attack. So instead, if you look at attacks 10 years ago and if you look at attacks now, mitigating an attack was much different then as compared to now, because it's not just one vector of attack like a SYN flood attack or a TCP flood attack that we see today. We see actually multiple different types of attack happening simultaneously. You'll see amplification attack along with a SYN flood attack along with a low and slow attack all simultaneous. So what happens is very difficult for security engineers to find out what is the signature of the attack and apply appropriate rule sets. So with this simultaneous vector, the attack becomes more sophisticated and harder to deal with. We've also seen cases of hit and run attacks. So there are various security measures against DDoS, which I'll talk about as we go forward. But typically the mitigation, the detection of an attack can take anywhere between 0 to 15 minutes. So these hit and run attacks, basically what they do is they send a small spike of traffic, a DDoS attack, which will last maybe for 1 minute, and then they will stop. And periodically after every 10 minutes or every 15 minutes, they'll keep on sending this small spike. Because the attack is not detected, because the duration of the attack is very small, what results as a consequence is that these attacks go unmitigated, and the responsiveness of the website and the user experience and the performance of the network, all of it starts to degrade. So this is another vector of how attackers are using the same attack and using it in a different way, just in a way to bypass existing security controls. And last of all is low and slow attacks. These are basically slow HTTP GET and POST requests, which completely go undetected because they're hardly sending huge any volume of traffic. These are very small packets sending very small bandwidth. And as a consequence, they completely go undetected. And what they do is they degrade the performance of the website and the web servers, consequently leading to poor user experience. So this is how over the past 10 years, these attacks have evolved. And if we talk about the mitigation strategy, now we know how the attackers operate. Let's look at how security controls have also evolved over a period of time. So initially we had on-premise devices. These devices used to be heavy equipments, which used to be put in line in data centers. And they used to handle all the traffic and identify attacks and mitigate them. Thereafter came the clean pipe services. These services started to come as an offering as part of the ISP, internet service providers. They said that we will manage the entire DDoS solution attack for you, and we will charge you so much so amount for providing a clean pipe service. So this is basically DDoS as a service provided by the ISP. Looking at the way ISP started to go, a lot of third-party vendors also started coming in and started offering DDoS as a service. Here, you don't have to be an ISP, but a third-party solution or a service provider, where you will divert the traffic onto your network, mitigate the attack, and send the clean traffic back to the actual user. So let's look at what are the pros and cons of each of them. If you talk about on-premise solution, these are most sophisticated of all the three solutions because they are able to detect as well as mitigate attacks in real time and fairly accurately because they're observing the traffic and profiling the traffic of genuine traffic and can easily classify what is not genuine and can mitigate it appropriately. They also have the advantage because most of the traffic today that we see is over HTTPS or SSL. Because the traffic is encrypted, these devices can be embedded with certificates that can offload this traffic, inspect attacks on the application layer, and can mitigate sophisticated attacks as well. Where these devices fail is in their inability to mitigate volumetric attacks. So if you have a data center with a bandwidth of say 100 Mbps and you get an attack of say 100 Gbps, there is no way this on-premise device will be able to mitigate such large volume of attack. And you will have to resort to another DDoS as a service provider, like a clean pipe service or DDoS service from third party. The other con of this solution, the on-premise solution, is that it's a security control which is in your network, so you will have to manage it. So you will have to have security team which knows how to operate on this product, how to use this product, how to configure it, and maintain its uptime and all the requirements that come with any security control that is inside the data center. If you move on to clean pipe service, their biggest advantage is that they can mitigate volumetric attack and they're completely managed because the ISP take control of the entire DDoS attack if there is, and they take the responsibility of mitigating the attack and providing clean traffic to the end user organization. The cons of such a service is that they cannot inspect HTTPS traffic. Also, they are not, being an ISP, they're not allowed to inspect application layer traffic. So they cannot mitigate any DDoS attack which is targeted at the application layer. Also, these services, the way they are implemented, can take large time to detect an attack, typically around 15 minutes to 30 minutes in some cases. And because they don't know what the genuine traffic looks like, their mitigation also cannot be accurate. So whenever the attack actually happens and these services get invoked, they'll only look at attack traffic and they try to mitigate with the best of their abilities. But because they don't know how to distinguish between genuine traffic and attack traffic, it is quite possible that using these services, even genuine customers may be denied access to your website. The third one is DDoS as a service. This is, as I said, is provided by third party. It has the same benefit as being able to mitigate large volume attacks, and it is completely managed. But the problem with this solution is fairly similar, that the attack mitigation cannot happen for application traffic, especially if the traffic is encrypted. Also, what happens with this kind of a mechanism is that when an attack actually is happening, the security teams have to alert these service providers that I'm facing an attack, can you please start mitigating at your end? So this is mostly manually triggered. And once the customer tells the service provider that I'm facing this attack, they start diverting the attack traffic and start mitigating. Again, as they don't have visibility into genuine traffic, they have the same problem that they lack in accuracy in identifying genuine from malicious traffic. So these are the three service options available to customers, but there's also another option. For those of you who are using cloud, like AWS services, Google Cloud, Azure, etc., all these cloud services also offer cloud-native DDoS protection. And there are also similar services on the cloud, which can provide you a protection against application layer traffic, especially HTTP traffic. Often these solutions are also bundled with web application firewall and CDN services. They fairly have a good detection and mitigation strategy, but the way they operate is somewhat different from other three services. Basically, what this service tries to do is to diffuse the attack. So if you have a large volume attack, and these services usually have a big network spanning across multiple countries. So they try to diffuse the attack by sending, say, there's a 100 Gbps attack, and they will distribute the attack like 10 Gbps in one location, 10 Gbps on another location. And by doing so, they are able to diffuse the attack and then perform the mitigation. So that way they ensure that the services which are hosted on their platform remain online, and at the same time they are able to mitigate large volume attack. So lastly, we'll talk about the DDoS best practices. So one thing that is clear that comes out is that there's no one single solution that can mitigate both network layer or volumetric attack as well as application layer attack. The only strategy that is there for the organization is to consider a hybrid approach. When we talk about DDoS mitigation, the biggest challenge does not come in terms of whether I have security solutions in place, but the ability of the security team and the networking team to know what to do when you are under a DDoS attack. Half of the time, I have seen that either the networking team says that it is a security issue, or the security team says that it's a networking issue, because after all, this is a network security problem. So an organization should always prepare their team and perform continuous DDoS drills, and also train their security team and networking team on how to handle such events. Because not only these attacks don't come invited, like they completely come uninvited, and when it happens, every minute you lose is equivalent to money lost. The most concerning aspect of the best practices that I have observed is in terms of the SLA. So if you are taking a clean pipe service, or if you're taking a cloud-based service or an on-premise solution, the problem comes in the SLA. Most of the SLAs today only talk about what is the uptime of your solution or your service. They say like it should be 99.99% uptime. But is that enough? So whenever you're buying a solution, you need to consider six questions. What is the mean time to detect an attack? How soon can you detect an attack? If there is no answer to that, then having a solution that is, or a service that is providing that mitigation, is as good as being completely useless. The other one is, how soon can you tell me that I am under a DDoS attack? When you're taking a service, you are expecting that the service provider is completely going to manage the attack for you. However, it is your solution, it is your organization, it is your network which is under attack. You should be told when your network, your organization is under an attack. So how soon can you tell that I am under attack? So that is known as mean time to alert. The third metric that should be there in SLA is mean time to respond. Say now I know that you are under a DDoS attack. How soon will I start responding? Do I have a 24/7 team which is sitting there and analyzing the traffic and telling that this is the attack that is happening, this is how I'm going to start the mitigation, and telling the customer that I am starting the mitigation now? So what is the mean time to respond? The fourth metric that should be there in the SLA is mean time to mitigate. How fast can you stop the attack? At the end of the day, a customer is buying these solution or these services so that they can effectively mitigate the attack. So how fast can you start the mitigation process? Will it take 5 minutes time? Will it take 10 minutes time? Will it take 10 seconds? Because all of this should actually be part of the SLA. It's not just about mitigating attack by dropping any or every traffic. A successful mitigation should ensure that it is mitigating only malicious traffic and allowing successful traffic to pass through, genuine traffic to pass through. A solution which starts dropping genuine traffic is not providing a quality protection, because at the end of the day, the services starts to deteriorate and the attack still becomes successful because the user experience starts going bad. And yes, reliability, that what is the uptime of the service or the solution, that it being 99.99%, that is an SLA which I've seen in most of the cases should always be there as one of the metrics to be observed. So that said, these are the certain best practices. One last note, many organizations today feel that I have a firewall or I have a DDoS, I have a IPS or an IDS solution, or I may have a UTM solution. That also has a DDoS component. So do I need a separate DDoS appliance or a DDoS service? The answer to that is yes. The reason is each of these devices were built for a specific purpose. The purpose of firewall was to ensure to what traffic is allowed to pass through and what should be blocked. So it does the job of policing. IPS and IDS are used to prevent intrusion by looking at signatures of well-known attack signatures and blocking them proactively. But a DDoS attack is very different. A successful DDoS attack can also bring down firewall and IPS solution, as it happens about 31% of the times in most successful DDoS attacks. So these devices, while having the capability of DDoS protection, also lack the capability of identifying what is the signature of the attack. So having a specialized solution will definitely help in preparing your organization against such threat vectors. But the question of which solution to take or which services to take depends largely on which sector do you belong to and what is the trend in that sector. As we see today, most of the attacks are targeted towards financial sector, but that is that pattern is also changing. We are seeing more attacks happening on game services. We are seeing more attacks happening on IT services, especially SaaS services. And we are seeing more attacks happening against SMB as well. What strategy suits best for you depends on what industry you belong to and what is your budget and what would happen in case of a successful DDoS attack. What are the implications? Based on those implications, you need to decide what should be your strategy in mitigating the risk of DDoS.